From Lectures in America by Gertrude Stein. Plays. In a book I wrote called How to Write, I made a discovery which I considered fundamental, that sentences are not emotional, and that paragraphs are. I found out about language that paragraphs are emotional, and sentences are not, and I found out something else about it. I found out that this difference was not a contradiction, but a combination, and that this combination causes one to think endlessly about sentences and paragraphs, because the emotional paragraphs are made up of unemotional sentences. I found out a fundamental thing about plays. The thing I found out about plays was, too, a combination and not a contradiction, and it was something that makes one think endlessly about plays. That something is this. The thing that is fundamental about plays is that the scene, as depicted on the stage, is more often than not, one might say, it is almost always, in syncopated time in relation to the emotion of anybody in the audience. What this says is this. Your sensation as one in the audience in relation to the play played before you, your sensation, I say your emotion concerning that play, is always either behind or ahead of the play at which you are looking and to which you are listening. So your emotion, as a member of the audience, is never going on at the same time as the action of the play. This thing, the fact that your emotional time as an audience is not the same as the emotional time of the play, is what makes one endlessly troubled about a play. Because not only is there a thing to know as to why this is so, but also there is a thing to know why, perhaps, it does not need to be so. This is a thing to know. And knowledge, as anybody can know, is a thing to get by getting. And so I will try to tell you what I had to get, and what perhaps I have gotten in plays. And to do so, I will tell you all that I have ever felt about plays, or about any play. Plays are either read, or heard, or seen. And there then comes the question which comes first, and which is first, reading or hearing or seeing a play. I ask you, what is knowledge? Of course, knowledge is what you know, and what you know is what you do know. What do I know about plays? In order to know, one must always go back. What was the first play I saw? And was I then already bothered? Bothered about the different tempo there is in the play and in yourself and your emotion in having the play go on in front of you? I think I may say I know that I was already troubled by this in that my first experience at a play. The thing seen and the emotion did not go on together. This that the thing seen and the thing felt about the thing seen not going on at the same tempo is what makes the being at the theater something that makes anybody nervous. The jazz bands made of this thing, the thing that makes you nervous at the theater, they made of this thing an end in itself. They made of this different tempo a something that was nothing but a difference in tempo between anybody and everybody, including all those doing it and all those hearing and seeing it. In the theater, of course, this difference in tempo is less violent, but still, it is there, and it does make anybody nervous. In the first place at the theater, there is the curtain, and the curtain already makes one feel that one is not going to have the same tempo as the thing that is there behind the curtain. The emotion of you on one side of the curtain and what is going on the other side of the curtain are not going to be going on together. One will always be behind or in front of the other. Then also beside the curtain, there is the audience, and the fact that they are, or will be, or will not be, in the way when the curtain goes up. That too makes for nervousness, and nervousness is the certain proof that the emotion of the one seeing and the emotion of the thing seen do not progress together. Nervousness consists in needing to go faster or to go slower so as to get together. It is that that makes anybody feel nervous. And is it a mistake that that is what the theater is? or is it not? There are things that are exciting as the theatre is exciting, but do they make you nervous, or do they not? And if they do, and if they do not, why do they, and why do they not? Let us think of three different kinds of things that are exciting and that make or do not make one nervous. First, any scene which is a real scene, something real that is happening in which one takes part as an actor in that scene. Second, any book that is exciting. Third, the theater, at which one sees an exciting action in which one does not take part. Now, in a real scene in which one takes part, at which one is an actor, what does one feel as to time, and what is it that does or does not make one nervous? And is your feeling at such a time ahead or behind the action, the way it is when you are at the theater? It is the same, and it is not. But more not. If you are taking part in an actual violent scene, and you talk, and they or he or she talk, and it goes on and it gets more exciting, and finally then it happens, whatever it is that does happen, then, when it happens, then, at the moment of happening, is it a relief from the excitement, or is it a completion of the excitement? In the real thing, it is a completion of the excitement. In the theater, it is a relief from the excitement. And in that difference, the difference between completion and relief is the difference between emotion concerning a thing seen on the stage and the emotion concerning a real presentation, that is, really something happening. I wish to illustrate this from a bit of The Making of Americans. This one, and the one I am now beginning describing, is Martha Hersland, and this is a little story of the acting in her, of her being, in her very young living. This one was a very little one then, and she was running, and she was in the street, and it was a muddy one, and she had an umbrella that she was dragging, and she was crying. "I will throw the umbrella in the mud," she was saying. She was very little then. She was just beginning her schooling. "I will throw the umbrella in the mud," she said, and no one was near her, and she was dragging the umbrella, and bitterness possessed her. "I will throw the umbrella in the mud," she was saying, and nobody heard her. The others had run ahead to get home, and they had left her. "I will throw the umbrella in the mud," and there was desperate anger in her. "I have throwed the umbrella in the mud," burst from her. She had thrown the umbrella in the mud, and that was the end of it all in her. She had thrown the umbrella in the mud, and no one heard her as it burst from her. "I have throwed the umbrella in the mud." It was the end of all that to her. This, then, is the fundamental difference between excitement in real life and on the stage. In real life, it culminates in a sense of completion, whether an exciting act or an exciting emotion has been done or not. And on the stage, the exciting climax is a relief. And the memory of the two things is different. As you go over the detail that leads to culmination of any scene in real life, you find that each time you cannot get completion, but you can get relief. And so already your memory of any exciting scene in which you have taken part turns it into the thing seen or heard, not the thing felt. You have, as I say, as the result, relief rather than culmination, relief from excitement rather than the climax of excitement. In this respect, an exciting story does the same, only in the exciting story you, so to speak, have control of it, as you have in your memory of a really exciting scene. It is not as it is on the stage, a thing over which you have no real control. You can, with an exciting story, find out the end, and so begin over again, just as you can in remembering an exciting scene. But the stage is different. It is not real, and yet it is not within your control, as the memory of an exciting thing is, or the reading of an exciting book. No matter how well you know the end of the stage story, it is nevertheless not within your control, as the memory of an exciting thing is, or as the written story of an exciting thing is, or even, in a curious way, the heard story of an exciting thing is. And what is the reason for this difference? And what does it do to the stage? It makes for nervousness, that, of course, and the cause of nervousness is the fact that the emotion of the one seeing the play is always ahead or behind the play. Beside all this, there is a thing to be realized, and that is how you are being introduced to the characters who take part in an exciting action, even when you yourself are one of the actors. And this, too, has to be very much thought about. And thought about in relation to an exciting real thing, to an exciting book, to an exciting theater. How you are introduced to the characters. There are, then, the three ways of having something be exciting. And the excitement may or may not make one nervous. A book being read that is exciting, a scene in which one takes part or an action in which one takes part, and the theater, at which one looks on. In each case, the excitement and the nervousness and the being behind or ahead in one's feeling is different. First, anything exciting in which one takes part. There, one progresses forward and back emotionally, and at the supreme crisis of the scene in which one takes part, in which one's hopes and loves and fears take part, at the extreme crisis of this thing, one is almost one with one's emotions. The action and the emotion go together. There is but just a moment of this coordination, but it does exist. Otherwise, there is no completion, as one has no result, no result of a scene in which one has taken part. And so, instinctively, when any people are living an exciting moment one with another, they go on and on and on until the thing has come together, the emotion, the action, the excitement. And that is the way it is when there is any violence, either of loving or hating or quarreling or losing or succeeding. But there is. There has to be the moment of it all being abreast the emotion, the excitement and the action. Otherwise, there would be no succeeding and no failing, and so no one would go on living. Why, yes, of course not. That is life, the way it is lived. Why, yes, of course. And there is a reasonable, and sometimes an unreasonable, and very often not a reasonable amount of excitement in everybody's life. And when it happens that way. Now, when you read a book, how is it? Well, it is not exactly like that. No, not even when a book is even more exciting than any excitement one has ever had. In the first place, one can always look at the end of the book and so quiet down one's excitement. The excitement having been quieted down, one can enjoy the excitement, just as anyone can enjoy the excitement of anything having happened to them by remembering, and so tasting it over and over again, but each time less intensely, and each time until it is all over. Those who like to read books over and over get continuously this sensation of the excitement, as if it were a pleasant distant thunder that rolls and rolls and rolls, and the more it rolls, well, the further it rolls, the pleasanter, until it does not roll any more. That is, until at last you have read the book so often that it no longer holds any excitement, not even ever so faintly. And then you have to wait until you have forgotten it, and you can begin it again. Now, the theater has still another way of being all this to you, the thing causing your emotion and the excitement in connection with it. Of course, lots of other things can do these things to lots of other people, that is to say, excite lots of people. But as I have said, knowledge is what you know. And naturally, I will tell you what I know, as I do so very essentially believe in knowledge. So then, once again, what does the theater do? And how does it do it? What happens on the stage? And how? And how does one feel about it? That is the thing to know, and to tell it as so. Is the thing seen or the thing heard the thing that makes most of its impression upon you at the theater? How much has the hearing to do with it, and how little? Does the thing heard replace the thing seen? Does it help it, or does it interfere with it? And when you are taking part in something really happening that is exciting, how is it? Does the thing seen or the thing heard affect you, and affect you at the same time or in the same degree, or does it not? Can you wait to hear, or can you wait to see, and which excites you the most? And what has either one to do with the completion of the excitement, when the excitement is a real excitement that is excited by something really happening? And then, little by little, does the hearing replace the seeing? Or does the seeing replace the hearing? Do they go together, or do they not? And when the exciting something in which you have taken part arrives at its completion, does the hearing replace the seeing, or does it not? Does the seeing replace the hearing, or does it not? Or do they both go on together? All this is very important, and important for me, and important, just important. It has, of course, a great deal to do with the theatre. A great, great deal. In connection with reading an exciting book, the thing is again more complicated than just seeing, because, of course, in reading, one sees, but one also hears. And when the story is at its most exciting, does one hear more than one sees? Or does one not do so? I am posing all these questions to you, because, of course, in writing, all these things are things that are really most entirely really exciting. But, of course, yes. And in asking a question, one is not answering, but one is, as one may say, deciding about knowledge. Knowing is what you know, and in asking these questions, although there is no one who answers these questions, there is in them that there is knowledge. Knowledge is what you know. And now, is the thing seen or the thing heard the thing that makes most of its impression upon you at the theatre? And does, as the scene on the theatre proceeds, does the hearing take the place of seeing, as perhaps it does when something real is being most exciting? Or does seeing take the place of hearing, as perhaps it does when anything real is happening? Or does the mixture get to be more mixed seeing and hearing, as perhaps it does when anything really exciting is really happening? If the emotion of the person looking at the theatre does or does not do what it would do if it were really a real something that was happening, and they were taking part in it, or they were looking at it, when the emotion of the person looking on at the theatre comes then at the climax to relief rather than completion, has the mixture of seeing and hearing something to do with this? And does this mixture have something to do with the nervousness of the emotion at the theatre, which perhaps has to do with the fact that the emotion of the person at the theatre is always behind and ahead of the scene at the theatre, but not with it? There are then quite a number of things that anyone does or does not know. Does the thing heard replace the thing seen? Does it help it? Or does it interfere with it? Does the thing seen replace the thing heard? Or does it help? Or does it interfere with it? I suppose one might have gotten to know a good deal about these things from the cinema, and how it changed from sight to sound, and how much before there was real sound, how much of the sight was sound, or how much it was not. In other words, the cinema undoubtedly had a new way of understanding sight and sound in relation to emotion and time. I may say that, as a matter of fact, the thing which has induced a person like myself to constantly think about the theatre from the standpoint of sight and sound and its relation to emotion and time, rather than in relation to story and action, is the same, as you may say, general form of conception as the inevitable experiments made by the cinema, although the method of doing so has naturally nothing to do with the other. I myself never go to the cinema, or hardly ever, practically never, and the cinema has never read my work, or hardly ever. The fact remains that there is the same impulse to solve the problem of time in relation to emotion, and the relation of the scene to the emotion of the audience, in the one case as in the other. There is the same impulse to solve the problem of the relation of seeing and hearing in the one case as in the other. It is, in short, the inevitable problem of anybody living in the composition of the present time. That is, living as we are now living, as we have it, and now do live in it. The business of art, as I tried to explain in composition as explanation, is to live in the actual present. That is, the complete, actual present, and to completely express that complete, actual present.